He willingly made a deal with the demon, pledging to murder innocent women in exchange for a reward. But what exactly were the details behind his dark and twisted contract? And, more important, how did no one see the signs? My name is Adrian, and welcome back to another video by Coffeehouse Crime. In today's case, we're looking at the lives of Bibaa Henry and Nicole Smallman, and how their lives were tragically taken from them by the callous and greedy hands of a deluded man. And honestly, the reasoning behind this crime is extremely bizarre. By the way, I post solved, unsolved, and strange cases here on a weekly basis, so if that sounds like your kind of thing, please consider subscribing to Coffeehouse Crime. Who is Danyal Hussein? What deal did he make with the demon, and why? Pull up a seat, grab a coffee, and sit back. This is the case of Danyal Hussein. Our story begins in London. With a population of 9 million residents, and being home to just over 13% of the UK's entire population, London is a large city with a very strong pulse. In fact, it is arguably one of the most important cities on the planet. Alongside New York, it is one of the world's largest financial centres. With thanks to its time zones, making it a competitive area for American and Asian business, most international business headquarters are based here. And despite its congested air traffic, it also takes the Silver Crown in having the best global air connections in the world, only being succeeded by Dubai. Due to its weather, culture, and way of living, you will either love or hate this city. But there is no denying its success in bringing in over 30 million tourists every year. We're travelling to the northwestern suburb of Wembley, most notably known for Wembley Stadium, which can hold up to 90,000 people in any given football match. And it is here in Wembley lived 46-year-old Bibaa Henry. Bibaa was born in 1974 to her mother Mina Henry and father Herman Henry, both of which were very interesting and successful characters. Mina was the Church of England's first black female archdeacon. Herman was a retired boxer. Described by her mother as a woman who had the heart of a lion, Bibaa was very forthright and strong. And although she was only 5 feet tall, she more than made up her height with profound confidence and warmth. Bibaa personally found her niche in life when she became a social worker for Buckinghamshire Council. She always had expressed her interest in looking after the vulnerable, and she was described by her family as being a passionate advocate for safeguarding vulnerable children and families. By the time Bibaa had reached young adulthood, her mother and father had sadly divorced, and by the year of 1992, her mother Mina had remarried to a man named Christopher Smallman. Mina and Christopher would eventually decide to have a child of their very own, and by the year of 1994, the two would finally bring in Nicole Smallman to the world. Being the half-sister to Bibaa, Nicole was 20 years younger, and although her personality was just as vibrant, she was very different too. Described as someone who should have been born in the 60s, Nicole had a lot of love to give to those around her. She didn't care about how she looked, or what people thought of her. She just wanted to have fun, and was a real treasure to talk to. Nicole would grow through her teenage years with a keen interest in the creative world. She attended the Arts Educational School in London, before eventually beginning her studies in the University of Westminster. She was also a freelance photographer, creating her own business called Nicole Smallman Photography. During her time at university, she was based on Harrow campus, located just north of Wembley Park, and after completing her first year in halls of residence, also known as dormitories, she decided to save a bit of cash by living with her older sister, Bibaa. Bibaa had a flat nearby in Wembley, and she also had space. The two sisters were already very good friends, but moving in together had brought them even closer. They were very much a yin and yang to one another, two very different halves that complemented each other rather than oppose. Bibaa was strong, confident, assertive, and Nicole, gentle and warming. Their mother would refer to the two of them as Bibaa the Spitfire and Nikki the Flower Girl. We're moving forward to the 6th of June 2020. It was a Friday, and summer was just about starting in England. Granted, it was still a little on the chilly side, with temperatures only reaching 16 degrees Celsius or 60 degrees Fahrenheit. but it was a sunny day, and the start of what should be a great weekend. Nicole and Bibaa had started making plans. It was Bibaa's birthday, and to celebrate, they decided to meet up with a small group of friends in Friant Country Park. With the pandemic still being a relatively new thing, they had to be careful with their birthday plans. And while it would be a nice thing to get a large group of friends together, maybe a smaller one would do, just for this year. The weather was calm, and with no cloud in sight, they decided that a picnic was the perfect activity for this evening. Later on that day, a surveillance camera captured the two entering a convenience store before buying food and drinks at a cooperative supermarket located in Kingsbury. They then drove to the park in a purple Audi, and at 6:38 p.m, two more cameras spotted the pair walking into Friant Country Park, ready to begin their evening of food, drinks, and friends. There would be a total of 8 people that evening. Pictures captured by friends showed off Bibaa opening birthday cards as Nicole cheerfully sat by. And another camera showed the group smiling from ear to ear. Maybe it was the sun, the birthday celebrations, or even a short return to normalcy from the pandemic. But the two women were undeniably in their element. They were happy, and in the moment. As the sun set and the evening turned into night, temperatures across London started dropping, as did the group's energy levels. Friends started leaving the park at different intervals throughout that evening, and it was around midnight that the final group of friends made their way home, including Nicole's boyfriend, Adam. However, Nicole and Bibaa were not quite done yet. They decided to hang back a while longer to dance in the dark with fairy lights, and clean up the picnic and its supplies. Adam texted Nicole later on to ask how it was going. She texted her boyfriend back with, "I'm dancing in a field." And after placing their phone down on a tripod, the sisters began to swing chains of fairy lights into the night sky. Nicole held the back while Bibaa danced away. But after this text message and this photograph, Nicole and Bibaa would fall silent. Both sisters never made it back to their apartment that night. And over the following morning, Adam started to worry over the whereabouts of his girlfriend. She hadn't responded to any of his recent messages, and he couldn't get in contact with Bibaa either. With Nicole being a real lover of animals and reptiles, Adam had bought her a bearded dragon. He noticed that she hadn't returned home to feed it, or asked him or anyone else to either. Which was a very troubling sign. She had always kept a keen eye on his eating schedule. Upon asking the housemate if the two had ever returned home the night before, the answer was no. And when he tried to trace Nicole's mobile phone using Find My Friends, nothing came up either. He phoned anyone he thought could know their whereabouts, but no positive leads came through. It seemed as if the two women had simply just vanished. As far as Adam was concerned, this was a really, really bad sign. Not only was this out of character for Nicole and Bibaa, but all possible avenues to explain where they could be had been exhausted too. It was in this moment that Adam sought help from the police, attempting to file a missing persons report for both sisters. But authorities reacted with very little energy. They didn't seem to understand the urgency of the situation. Adam reached out to their mother, Mina Henry. And between the two, they grew a small task force to track down mutual friends, reaching out to people on Facebook and eventually beginning a search party of their very own. But as the sun set on Saturday, which was almost 24 hours since their disappearance, they were still none the wiser in finding Nicole or Bibaa. As Sunday morning began, police were still sluggish in their efforts, and with a persistent lack of help from authorities, Adam, along with his parents and an additional friend Nina, travelled to the park to retrace the sisters' footsteps. Upon arriving, they would find Bibaa's sunglasses, which was a troubling discovery. She never went anywhere without them. While Nina took those sunglasses to the police, Adam and his father would carry on looking for Nicole and Bibaa. Worryingly, his father eventually found a bloody knife. And soon after that, Adam would find something much, much worse. Upon searching through a row of unkept bushes, he had found the body of his girlfriend and her sister. They were both lifeless and intertwined. Their eyes were open, blank, and dull, and stab wounds were visible all over their bodies. Finding the body of a loved one covered in stab wounds and dumped into a bush must be one of the most difficult emotions to process. Adam dropped to his knees and screamed. Soon after, his father would find him and the bodies. Adam would then have to call their mother to tell her the news. Mina responded in the exact same way that Adam did. She had just lost two of her three daughters overnight. Very different to the initial 36 hours of their disappearance, police responded with urgency after learning about the bodies. They reached the park shortly after 1 p.m, where they then secured the perimeter and started searching for evidence. Not that this would make any difference. The world had already lost Bibaa Henry and Nicole Smallman, and the one to find their bodies would be Nicole's own boyfriend. As the long road of grief began for family and friends, officers would find a blood-stained cushion, the same one taken in a picture at the picnic only 2 days before. Now gruesome evidence to a crime scene. They would also find a bag with their picnic blankets. And at the bottom of a pond, a mobile phone and bank cards that belonged to Bibaa. As the park remained shut, flowers and bouquets were left at several entrances, in an expression of condolence and sorrow toward the loss of Bibaa and Nicole. And now, the next big question to emerge from this story was who was capable of doing such a thing? Who murdered these two women? And why? Unfortunately, before this question could even begin to be answered, further pain would be inflicted to relatives and friends. Two police officers, who were assigned to protect the scene after the incident, would tragically take selfies in front of Nicole's and Bibaa's dead bodies, before leaking them to a personal WhatsApp group with over 40 members and additional friends. And the actions of these two idiots would ignite fresh anger at the police force, and cause further grief to a family who were already experiencing the most difficult time of their lives. PC Dennis Jaffa and PC Jamie Lewis were suspended immediately. As the dust began to settle, both forensics and detectives were hard at work trying to find their suspect. And, fortunately, they had a lead from the very beginning. It appeared that, as Nicole and Bibaa were being murdered, at least one of them had desperately tried to protect the other by fighting back. Nicole's hands were covered in stab wounds, most likely from trying to take control of the knife. And this same knife, which was retrieved at the crime scene, would reveal not only the blood of the victims, but the blood of a third unidentified individual too. It would take several days for analysis of this DNA to come back with a result. And within that same month, the DNA had finally made a familial link, meaning that the blood partially matched the DNA profile of someone already on the database. And although this person's profile didn't fully match, it did mean that they were most likely related to the suspect. Police, who were investigating all possible members of this family, would soon after make a very compelling discovery through a surveillance camera at a nearby supermarket. At 3:48 p.m. on the 3rd of June 2020, cameras captured a man walking into an Asda supermarket before purchasing drinks, candles, a set of kitchen knives, and gum. The set of kitchen knives did match the knife that was found at the crime scene, and the reason why they were interested in this footage in the first place was because the purchase had been made by a customer with the same surname as the DNA profile. With a family link to the partially matching DNA profile, a purchase matching the murder weapon, and an address that wasn't even 1 mile from Fryant Country Park, police were very interested in this young man, and he went by the name of Danyal Hussein. And by the late hours of June the 30th, police believed they finally had enough evidence to arrest Danyal on suspicion of murder, which is why in the early hours of the 1st of July, officers decided to pay him a visit.
Mate, you're under arrest. Come out. Come out the address. Keep walking towards me. Keep walking towards me. Stay where you are. Stay where you are. Stay where you are. Hands on your head. Stay where you are. Face me. Hands on your head. Stay where you are. You're under arrest, all right?
Yeah, told him to do it. Give him to face the car. Yeah?
Yeah. Officers who arrived at Hussein's mother's address in Blackheath were equipped with taser guns and riot shields. They arrested him swiftly, before taking him down to Wandsworth police station for questioning. The entire time, he seemed subdued and vacant.
Have any injuries?
Yeah.
The wrists from the cuffs?
No.
Oh. How did that happen?
Oh, is this the interview?
That was a question. Oh, the injuries on your fingers. What happened there? Okay, don't worry.
I was getting the one.
I am sure that this is the moment Daniel realizes the weight of the situation. Quite clearly, he knows it's game over.
Any medical conditions, asthma, diabetes, blood pressure, heart conditions, anything like that? You don't need to be. The questions are asked to everyone that comes into custody.
So you're writing down on my chest.
All right, just listen to what
I thought you were supposed to do an official interview before asking me the actual question.
You will be interviewed later. And what this is at the time, it's you just being booked in. Okay. Any mental health issues? Any mental health issues?
No.
Have you ever tried to harm yourself? How do you feel right now?
I'm really shocked, to be honest. I'm really confused and scared. I don't know what's going on exactly.
Following his arrest, officers would seize both his mother's and his father's property, and what they would find would be a mountain of disturbing and incriminating evidence. I'm not even talking about slightly suggestive evidence here. You don't get much more obvious than this. Starting in his mother's home, they would discover satanic symbols over the walls and door of his bedroom. And upon looking even closer, investigators found a letter. The letter was addressed to King Lucifuge Rofakal. According to demonology, Lucifuge is a demon who is in charge of Hell's government by the order of Lucifer. And in Danyal's letter to him, he asked for the following.
Agreement for the mighty King Lucifuge Rofakal. For you, I will perform a minimum of 6 sacrifices every 6 months, for as long as I am free and physically capable. I will sacrifice only women, build a temple for you, and do everything that I have promised. For me, I will win the Mega Millions Super Jackpot, and receive fruitful rewards in return for the future sacrifices that I make to you. The rewards could consist of wealth and power. I will never be suspected of any crimes by the police, and also that the police will never know of any crimes that I have done and that I will do. Signed, Danyal.
Rather disturbingly, he had signed his name in his own blood, which is kind of fucked up. Investigators would also find 3 lottery tickets in his bedroom, those lottery tickets being purchased just before Bibaa and Nicole were murdered. It seemed as if he was very serious about his intentions written in the letter. Additional CCTV footage acquired over the following days would reveal a lot more about Danyal and his whereabouts. Starting off with the surveillance footage that showed him purchasing knives at Asda only 2 days before the murders, bank statements would highlight that he had ordered a full face mask and a shovel from Amazon the very next day. And on the night of their deaths, a surveillance camera next door to Danyal's house would also capture Danyal leaving his home at 7:42 p.m. Another camera would capture him walking towards the park just 1 minute later. And a further 10 minutes after this, he was also recorded at a bus stop located even closer to the park. Danyal would return to his home several hours later at 3:08 a.m, only 2 hours after Nicole and Bibaa had been killed. He wasn't wearing any trousers, and appeared to be concealing a bandaged hand in his jumper, perhaps because he had hurt his hand that night. At around 6 p.m. that very same day, Danyal then attended Northwick Park Hospital, where he requested treatment for cuts to his right hand. When asked how he received those injuries, he told one doctor that he was mugged, and another that he was attacked by a group of boys. Danyal then called his bank on the 16th of June to request for a new card, claiming that he had lost it a few weeks prior and had noticed several unrecognised transactions in his bank statement. However, this lie was unravelled pretty quickly when officers realised that he was using that same card in the footage at Asda. By this stage of the investigation, Danyal's web of lies, deceit and violence were very obvious to investigators. All they had to do now was collect as much evidence as they could and wait for his trial to begin. But as his trial loomed closer, Danyal and his lawyer would change strategies and try to blame his actions on his diagnosis of autistic spectrum disorder, and other details would emerge from the woodwork too. In fact, as investigators started searching into Danyal's history, they would find that he had a very dark and disturbing past. From October 2017 through to May 2018, Danyal was actually being monitored by the Prevent Strategy, a department run by the Home Office to monitor individuals at risk from becoming terrorists. He was 15 at the time, and had been caught accessing far-right material on a computer at his secondary school. Danyal was also a keen watcher of a YouTuber named Coetting, a member of the Satanic Order of Nine Angles, who had also been previously convicted on charges of drugs and weapon offences. Disappointingly, Coetting's videos and websites included instructions for ritualistic murder, and those instructions were very resemblant of Danyal's own actions. It seemed as if he had taken direct influence from this man. Danyal was also active on a satanic forum where he claimed to be a psychic vampire, and asked for advice about demonic pacts. It is worth mentioning that the vast majority of Satanists are not violent, but it is possible to find violent minorities like Danyal Hussein, Coetting, and Pazuzu Algarad. Nevertheless, the consequences to Daniel's actions would be profound, not only to the family and friends of Bibaa and Nicole, but to everyone else watching among the discourse. Autopsy results would eventually confirm that both women had died from stab wounds. It is likely that Bibaa died first. She was taken by surprise in the incident, and never had a chance to fight her killer. Nicole, on the other hand, gallantly fought back to save her sister and herself. But unfortunately, she was overpowered, and she herself suffered over 40 stab wounds before finding her own death. Only moments before this, Nicole and Bibaa had taken this selfie at 1:13 a.m. Investigators believe that this image was taken exactly at the time that Danyal was approaching them. Their attention likely focused on him himself. Following his arrest, where he was charged with 2 counts of murder, Danyal pleaded not guilty at the Old Bailey on the 11th of March 2021. His trial would begin on the 9th of June that same year, before being convicted of both murders on the 6th of July. With the English law, which doesn't allow a judge to impose a full life tariff on an individual below the age of 21 years, Danyal was given a life sentence with a minimum of 37 years in prison, where he may then be reconsidered for release, which means that he may be back on the streets in the year 2057. There would be other consequences for those outlying offenders too. Following independent reviews of his online content, Coetting was eventually banned from Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube for his violent content that influenced Danyal to kill these innocent women. And the police officers, who were found to have taken selfies of Nicole's and Bieber's dead bodies, have since pleaded guilty to misconduct, admitting that they had taken a total of 6 pictures, before referring to them as, quote, 2 dead birds in a group chat. Mina Smallman, who refers to PC Dennis Jaffa and PC Jamie Lewis as Despicable 1 and Despicable 2, has since called for action, demanding that the Metropolitan Police drill down and get rid of the rot once and for all.
This is an unbelievable day for us, but it's the first, and there are 2 more battles to go. But today we remember our girls as the wonderful, strong women they were. And we hope that some good will come out of this horrible story. Thank you.
Dennis and Jamie will be sentenced at a later date. Following their deaths, a vigil in honour of Nicole's and Bibaa's memory was organised in Friant Country Park, taking place in the exact spot that the two had spent their last evening alive. Candles were lit as loved ones recalled memories and expressed the effects that their absence had had on their lives. Learning about this case, it's clear to see that Bibaa and Nicole were two young women with very nurturing personalities. Even through their occupations, they had a lot of care and creativity to give back to the world. It's a tragedy that they met their deaths by doing something they loved, spending time with friends, sharing food and drinks in a park underneath a sunset. They were living in the moment, and celebrating life itself in each other's company. With dark irony, their way of living matched the quote that was on their cushion. Life isn't about waiting for the storm to pass. It's about learning to dance in the rain. With Danyal's written agreement to a demon, it seems as if his real intention was to kill six women every 6 months. And with that said, it's very fortunate that he was caught so quickly. London could have otherwise seen more death and more tragedy, even a serial killer. And although investigators did do a good job in catching him quickly, it's inexcusable how long they'd taken to kickstart investigations over their disappearance. I'll be watching this case closely in the future. I hope that these two bozos get the punishment that they deserve. On the other hand, I find it very inspiring how strong Mina Smallman is, and I hope that over time, she and her family and friends find the comfort and peace that they all need. Thank you so much for watching another video today by Coffeehouse Crime. This one pulled my emotions all over the place. What do you think about Danyal Hussein? Do you think his sentence is too lenient? And do you think the police should have done more? Let me know what you think in the comments down below. Please remember to like the video if you found this case interesting, and consider subscribing if you like true crime. I post once or twice a week here. That is all I have for today, but thank you once again for being here. I'll be back again soon, but until then, look after each other. Goodbye.